Okay, I'm Javier. I will talk about the wavelength calibration-free oximetry. First, I will start describing the multispectral device we use for this research. Then I will introduce the, explain the how we do oximetry with eight wavelengths and the results we have obtained, and how we can make it insensitive to ocular opacity. So basically, IRIS is an assembly of waveplates and Wolfram prints that multiplexes one image in a set of spectrally distinct images. So basically, obtain, in our case, in the case for this research, eight images with eight distinct wavelengths. Here you can see our setup, the regular top fundus camera, top confundus camera, and iris and all the cameras. So iris, the advantage of iris over other spectral devices is that it's a snapshot device which don't produce movement artifacts and which has 100% transmission, which is quite good to produce good images with good SNR. So one of the problems with iris is the existence of side loops. Here you can see the main lobe and the other spectral side lobe. This is the transmission of the eight bands of iris, and this will be the on the right you can see the an image of red blood cells and Gauss images created by those side lobes. With the introduction of a filter plate, we basically eliminate those side lobes and then we clean the image, and we can properly analyze it in terms of spectrum and also spatially. So why do you say wavelengths? Basically because it allows for, it gives the possibility for doing absolute oxygen saturation measurements and improve oximetry, especially the robustness of it. In this case, we will have more measurements than variables, as I will show in the next slide. Having more measurements will allow us to identify things like vessel diameter, hematocrit, the path lengths, take into account also the scattered light from the cornea, which introduces the this is the opacity in the eye. Also take into account pigmentation and the focus on other aberrations. All these variables will have an effect in oximetry if they are not properly taken into account. So first the path lengths. We take into account single pass, which is light that pass, that is reflected back from the background, passes once through the vessel, which introduces one extra parameter, X1. Here S is the iris transmission and illumination, and R stands for the fundus reflectance. The next one will be double pass, which is light that passes twice through the vessel after being reflected on the background. It adds another extra parameter, X2, and then backscatter light, which is light that never reaches the fundus but is backscattered from the vessel directly. And this one adds two more parameters, X3 and X4. Secondly, we have the contrast reduction, which is basically scattered light from sources like the cornea, the lens, the vitreous, or even tissue. This scattered light introduces an offset in intensity. So we have a regular retinal image, and with this added offset, we look like that. So in effect, what we will have in terms of when we do a vessel profile, it's an increase on intensity, creating an optical density smaller than what it should be. This will have a big effect, will have an effect when you try to retrieve the oxygen saturation of that vessel. So to show, sort of validate how it works, the contrast reduction, we did a simple experiment with a model eye, introducing a glass capillary filled with 50% oxygen saturation. Sorry. So, and then we solve the, you can see here the raw data, raw transmission in black, and we fitted a single pass model, which considering that we have a spectrum as a background, single pass will be the main contributor for the transmission in this case. So we fit to the old raw data, this expression here, that will be single pass only. And we obtained a really bad fit and an oxygen saturation that is completely off. It's 45 off, basically. So now we introduce the contrast reduction factor, which is a multiplicative and also an additive factor. The way it works is that when K is zero, there is no contrast reduction, and we have the transmission back the way it should be. And when K is one, we basically cannot detect the vessel because the contrast is just it's extremely bad. So after applying the model with the contrast reduction, we obtain an improvement. It's still off by 9%, but the fit is way better and the saturation is closer. The offset is probably because we are neglecting the other path lengths. Even they are a minority, they will still have an effect. Also, we have the problem with their occupation. So the complete physical model that we have is this one, which is quite long. It has single pass, double pass, backscattered, and the contrast reduction. In fact, we'll have 8 unknowns and 8 measurements, but we can reduce it to 7 unknowns because we can estimate the diameter. And then we'll have 7 unknowns, which will be x1, x2, x3, and x4, which are the parameters for the single, double, and backscattered. And we'll have oxygen saturation, OS, D, that is the diameter that one is eliminated. C, which is the molar concentration, and K, which is for the contrast reduction. So, doing some analysis of the model in some error propagation, we can predict how it will behave, which will be quite useful once I show you the results later. So we added a 1% error in transmission to each wavelength independently, and then we solved for for a model trying to retrieve the saturation. Here you can see for a range of contrast reduction from 0 to 3.9, because one is not, won't give us anything, and the oxygen saturation error. You can see some of the wavelengths have, they don't have much oxygen saturation error, but some of the others are quite huge, actually. You won't have this in when you use the model without the contrast reduction. This is basically because this factor here, this is the sensitivity of oxygen saturation to errors in transmission. So if you don't have this factor that you will have in the regular expression, Bill Lambert law, that you will still have an error propagation, but won't be too big of a problem. But once you introduce the contrast reduction, when K increases, this will be small, so this will be big, so it will escalate quite a lot, the oxygen saturation error. There are two cases worth focusing on. The first one is contrast reduction from 0.2 to 0.6. That are the ranges of contrast reduction that we have found when we have done the retina analysis. We can see how we can find errors, quite big errors in this range, although not so big for these wavelengths, but still we can expect to have big errors in some cases if the contrast reduction is too bad. And then in the region from 0.0 to 0.1, this is also interesting to show, because even for zero contrast reduction, for some wavelengths we'll have 2% error or 3% error, which is cannot be neglected. I mean, that's something that could not be ignored. But all wavelengths have a smaller oxygen saturation error. So in order to improve the, well, since we have 8 wavelengths and 8 and 7 variables, if we try to solve that, we'll have lots of variations along the vessel in the oxygen saturation. So we develop an oximetry algorithm to try to implement some stability in the measurements, by making some steps and some assumptions in each step. The first one is to solve the mean vessel transmission for the path lengths, well, basically for all the parameters, and we will assume that the concentration, the contrast reduction, and the oxygen saturation are constant out of the vessel, which can, it's more or less a sensible assumption, okay? So we'll keep the concentration and the contrast reduction for the next steps, and that now we solve for the, and the oxygen saturation as well. Now we'll solve for the path lengths, that they will vary along the vessel because we will find variations in pigmentation and vessel thickness and even illumination along the vessel, especially they are long, we have long vessels. So once we have found that, we'll solve again using these parameters we have found here and the oxygen saturation and the concentration. We solve again to find contrast reduction along the vessel. This is interesting because sometimes we can have local variations in contrast. We may have some tissue over some parts of the vessel which will reduce the contrast in that region. And finally, once we have, well, the final step is find the oxygen saturation using decay from here, the contrast reduction from here, the path length contribution from here, and the concentration from this step. So, first thing we tried, we compared it with other calibration-free models. The first one is this one. We first analyze the data pixel by pixel, so applying the fitting the models one by pixel by pixel along the vessel. Okay, the second model is this one, and the third model is the one we use. The fourth model is actually taken by from this paper, but in this paper they simplified the model and they used the simplified model in for the results. We can see more or less how, well, all three produce huge variations around the vessels, especially this one, this not too much, and then this one not so much. Still a bit better than this, but not too much. So now you will see what happens with once we apply the advanced oximetry algorithm with all the steps. In this case, it improves, although there is still some variations around the vessel. In this one, we have a better improvement, although we have big variations in this over here and there and there. And the last one, we basically don't see any variations. It's also important to notice that the scale it goes from, in this case, from minus 100 to 200, because basically in this case, in the two first models, we had values that are quite close to 200 and quite negative as well. While in the third model, the one we are using, we don't have that. They are above 100, but they are not that bad. So then we applied to, we did an experiment with some subjects of making them twice doing some non-moxia, hypoxia, to see if we could detect the changes. And well, we can. This is using two wavelengths, oximetry, just the calibration model, and this is using the algorithm. And well, yes, we can. We have these three vessels that don't behave as they should. And the most important thing is to see how we have values higher than 100 and below zero. This is from the error propagation I have shown before. Using our model, the errors play a huge effect and it can produce things like this. It's not desirable, but we can detect the changes, and in some cases there is another effect. Another example here, this was one vessel that is was well identified, and the contrast reduction in this one was, I mean, this vessel was slightly below, was more covered by tissue than the others, so the errors were higher in that one. In this case, for a specific wavelength, for an specific filter, there was more error because it was a bit dirty in that case, so that vein went all over the place. So you can see how sensitive is the model. But not everything is so bad. We can compare it with two wavelengths oximetry along the vessel. that is when we can see more variations, more problems, for example, in two-way oximetry, that you can lots of times see that platter's neck defect along it. Okay, so we compare it with applying the model in the pixel-by-pixel base method, that is the yellow one, then applying the retinal algorithm, that is the red one, and the two-way oximetry, that is the blue one. We can see how by applying the by solving the model pixel by pixel, it's give nonsense, basically. It varies a lot. But once we apply the algorithm, we obtain quite robust results. I mean, they vary less than geometry. We still have the problem of the offset, but it's from the basically from error propagation. I mean, it's really hard. It's extremely hard to obtain accurately the transmission, to do accurately the Bessel profile, and obtain accurately the minimum intensity and the other intensity to obtain the transmission. It's extremely difficult to. It's extremely easy to produce an error, and you have seen how 1% error produces a big error in oxysaturation. So we see here how we have, even that problem, we have improved the robustness of the method, at least most of the time. You can see here that it's not so bad, but it's comparable to two-wavelength oximetry. Alpha in this case is better, this is another vessel. So in conclusion, we have developed a new calibration-free oximetry technique, which provides higher stability and robustness. It produces unrealistic oxygen saturation due to error propagation in low contrast images. It's important to note that you won't have that big error propagation when the contrast is when you have good quality images without contrast reduction, that you will see in the next presentation by Marika. And well, there is more refinement needed in the model. For example, could be improved in some ways, like for example how the patterns can relate to each other, and we can also select another set of wavelengths that are less sensitive to those errors. That's all. Thank you.